Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome once again to the official launch of the Singapore Management University Overseas Center here in Jakarta. And our guest of honor has arrived on this evening. And ladies and gentlemen, with this, please join me in welcoming Minister of Education, Culture, Research and Technology of the Republic of Indonesia, His Excellency Bapak Nadiem Makarim. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the national anthem of the Republic of Indonesia. Standing for the national anthem of the Republic of Singapore. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. You may now take your seats. And a very good evening to everybody. A very good evening to our guest of honor, Minister of Education, Culture, Research, and Technology of the Republic of Indonesia, Excellency Bapak Nadiem Makarim. Selamat malam, Pak. Thank you so much for being with us today. And of course, Ambassador of Singapore to the Republic of Indonesia, His Excellency Mr. Kwok, Fook, Seng. Thank you so much for being with us. And members of the SMU Board of Trustees who are present with us today. Members of the Board of the SMU International Advisory Council in Indonesia. SMU President, Professor Lily Kong, welcome to Indonesia. And distinguished guests SMU alumni and students, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the official launch of the Singapore Management University Overseas Center in Jakarta. And we are most honored, of course, of our guest of honor, Mr. Nadiem Makarim, to be present with us here today this evening. My name is Karina Surya, and it's certainly an honor to be your host for this evening, and hopefully being part of a momentous evening that will only further solidify the friendship of the Republic of Indonesia with the Republic of Singapore in the future. And it gives me a great pleasure to finally open tonight's evening to invite SMU President Professor Lily Kong to deliver her welcoming remarks. Professor Kong?
Minister of Education, Culture, Research and Technology of Indonesia, His Excellency Nadiem Makarim, Ambassador of Singapore to Indonesia, His Excellency Kwok, members of the SMU Board of Trustees and the SMU International Advisory Council of Indonesia, distinguished guests, SMU community, ladies and gentlemen, a good evening and a very warm welcome. I'm absolutely delighted that SMU is able to realize its plan today of launching our very first overseas center, and we have selected Jakarta to be our first destination. Let me first situate the establishment of SMU's overseas centers within the context of our strategic plan as a university. Launched in 2020, we identified three strategic priorities to further build our education, research, and engagement work, focusing our entire institutional energies and expertise on these areas. These are digital transformation, sustainable living, and growth in Asia. In line with the growth in Asia strategic priority, we have identified the establishment of a network of overseas centers as an important step towards strengthening collaborations, enabling deeper cross-cultural understanding, and collectively contributing to the growth of the region. The overseas centers will allow SMU to drive deeper engagement with our trusted partners to successfully make meaningful impact on communities in different parts of Asia. We chose Jakarta to launch our very first overseas center for three primary reasons. First, looking ahead, Indonesia is Southeast Asia's largest economy and a rising regional economic powerhouse. It wields considerable influence over the future of both Asia and our more immediate region in Southeast Asia. Establishing our overseas center right here allows us to be where a lot of the action is, to participate meaningfully in and contribute to the growth story here in Indonesia. Second, even while we look into the future, we do not forget to look back. Indonesia is Singapore's long-standing bilateral partner, with whom we have excellent relations. Indonesia has been a close partner to SMU ever since our early days as an educational institution. We were established 22 years ago, and Indonesia has been a friend throughout. In all our years, our university has played host to exceptional and talented students and faculty members from Indonesia who have contributed to the growth of our university. In turn, SMU students have been sharing and growing their knowledge and skills through community service projects, exchange programs, and internships in Indonesia. We remember with gratitude the good partnerships we have had, and we hope we will continue to strengthen these relationships and expand the opportunities for collaboration with the Overseas Centre Jakarta, or OCJ, in the lead. So first, we look forward to the promise and potential of Indonesia. Second, we look backward to our existing and past strong relationships. Third, we value greatly our International Advisory Council, IAC, for Indonesia, which was established in 2018, comprising esteemed industry leaders from Indonesia. With the help of IAC Indonesia, led by Pak Edi Sariatmaja, founder and chairman of MTEC, SMU has strengthened our relationships in Indonesia, and many of our IAC members are here today, including our rotating chair, Pak Haryanto. The OCJ is a natural extension of our growing ties and a signal of our strong commitment to working with Indonesia. By establishing a local presence, we hope to further enable the cultivation and building of strong partnerships in Indonesia. Now, what will the OCJ actually do, you may ask? At a broad level, we will seek to deepen existing partnerships and collaborations, while also forming new ones. With who? With local academic institutions, with businesses, and with government agencies. These collaborations will facilitate student mobility, upskill local capabilities, and facilitate knowledge exchange. Let me take each of those in turn. First, student mobility. As a student some decades ago, having had the opportunity to spend time overseas was truly precious. It opened my eyes, it widened my horizons, it allowed me to make friends who have been friends for life. And this kind of student mobility is something that SMU completely believes in, and I know that this is fully aligned with Minister, your vision for Indonesian students. All SMU students must have at least one overseas exposure before they can graduate. It's a graduation requirement. Many of our students do more than one overseas stint, and they can do it for an internship, an exchange program, a short summer program, a language immersion program, community work, you name it. The opportunities are there. And why we found your vision so compelling, Minister, was because we fully believe and are behind that vision that you have for Indonesian students as well. And we want to play our part in being a good partner to you in Indonesia so that that student mobility between our countries can be enabled. It contributes to better cross-cultural understanding. It opens the eyes and hearts of young people to other ways of doing things, to extending new experiences that stays with them for life. OCJ will help to facilitate these movements. Second, OCJ will also contribute to efforts to upskill local capabilities in Indonesia. This upskilling activity is something that SMU has gone into with great energy and fervor in the last 5 years or so. We've always had some dimension of this, but in the last 5 years, we have given concerted attention to this in the context of Singapore. Our SMU Academy and our SMU Executive Development have grown tremendously in the programs that they offer for the C-suites, the PMETs, in the context of Singapore. We have learned some things from that that we think will be very useful for the region. And we would like very much to be able to offer those offerings to Indonesian businesses, workers, so that together we might be able to upskill and reskill the region, and a rising tide will raise all boats. So upskilling and reskilling is a second area that we hope to contribute in Indonesia. Third, knowledge sharing, knowledge exchange. OCJ will be host to myriad dialogues, forums, symposiums to facilitate knowledge exchange and to develop regular dialogues between academia and the public and private sectors. These could be public events or closed-door events, and will aim to bring cutting-edge research and expertise in areas such as sustainability and the digital transformation to support local communities, social and economic development. If we're able to bring some of the research insights that we have invested in to build to communities in the region, including the business and the public sector communities here in Indonesia, that investment in research will have been worthwhile. So, in these ways, we hope very much to work with local education and industry partners to support Indonesia's transition. And in particular, we note that the areas that we have picked as our strategic priorities are also areas of ambition in Indonesia to transit to a digital economy and a green economy. While we are officially launching the OCJ today and look forward to it delivering on its goals, no pressure, show up, we will be starting with several already established relationships. And this gives us every confidence that we are on a positive trajectory. Under Minister Nadiem Makarim's leadership, Indonesia's Ministry of Education, Culture, Research and Technology and Singapore's Ministry of Education entered into an agreement to promote the Human Capital Partnership Agreement in January this year. This agreement served as a catalyst for furthering strong education ties and partnerships between Indonesia and Singapore. The subsequent signing of the Youth Mobility Program in October 2022 is a further milestone in mutual efforts to enhance university students' access to cross-cultural learning opportunities in each other's countries. With the opening of OCJ, SMU hopes to be able to contribute meaningfully to the Human Capital Partnership Agreement. And as I said to the minister a moment ago, we volunteered and the Singapore Ministry of Education has agreed that we will be the university to coordinate all the universities in Singapore in partnership, working in partnership with Indonesia on the Youth Mobility Program. We will leverage our networks and our in-country presence in Indonesia to support these closer educational collaboration for Indonesian and Singaporean students. Minister, you may remember that you witnessed the signing of MOUs that we had between SMU and three very significant Indonesian universities a year and a half or so ago. We now have MOUs for academic collaboration with University Gajah Mada, Universitas Indonesia, and Institut Teknologi Bandung. In fact, some of our students are in Gajah Mada right now in a short-term program. Through these collaborations, SMU has been able to implement exchange and study programs, faculty-led study missions, and we've also developed joint SMU-X overseas courses where Indonesian students and SMU students are working collaboratively on projects with an industry partner and an industry challenge that they are seeking to find solutions to. So these SMU-X All courses, as we call them, are experiential learning modules. And again, we have a group of students here right now working on an SMU XO course. I think they're seated there and clapping for themselves. SMU, as I've said, is also involved in adult continuing education, and we already have government officials, executives from Indonesian state-owned enterprises, and multi-level leaders from the private sector who have attended our executive and other skills development programs with SMU. We have offered, and we will continue to offer, opportunities for Indonesian citizens to pursue undergraduate studies as well as postgraduate studies at SMU with scholarships and grant opportunities for eligible applicants. We do hope to be able to extend SMU's brand of holistic and transformative education to a broader base of deserving students from Indonesia. We believe that SMU, with the help of OCJ and all our partners, some of whom are represented here, can and will make a significant contribution to Indonesia's social and economic development while deepening the understanding, collaboration, and trust between our two countries. So I want to thank Minister for your leadership in enabling these partnerships between our countries, to all our IAC members, our Board of Trustees, who have been so supportive of our collaborations, and we will not let you down. To grace the official launch of SMU's Overseas Center Jakarta, we're deeply honored to have as our guest of honor, His Excellency Minister Nadiem Makarim, Minister of Education, Culture, Research, and Technology for Indonesia. A graduate of Brown University and Harvard Business School in the US, he worked as a consultant at McKinsey & Company, was co-founder and managing director at Zalora, and in 2019 founded Gojek, which needs no introduction. He was appointed Minister of Education, Culture, Research and Technology by President Jokowi to be on his second term cabinet and subsequently resigned from his post at Gojek. In 2016, Minister Nadiem Makarim became the first Indonesian to receive the Asian of the Year Award from the Singapore Straits Times. Previous recipients have included founder of Independent Singapore, Lee Kuan Yew, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi, former Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, and Chinese President Xi Jinping. In October 2020, Minister Nadiem Makarim was our keynote speaker at the SMU Industry Leaders Dialogue, where he shared his vision for higher education in Indonesia. That was when he shared with us his idea of Campus Merdeka, student mobility, global exposure, and so forth. And that was so powerful and resonated with us that we were convinced that we had to work still further with Indonesia. So thank you for your inspiration, Minister. We are once again privileged to have Minister join us here today for this very auspicious occasion. And Minister, thank you for engaging in the subsequent fireside chat with us. We're deeply grateful to you. And to this evening's SMU Presidential Distinguished Lecturer Series panelists who are seated in the audience and all our guests here, I want to thank you very much for your past and present support, and we look forward to continuing that partnership with you and look forward to having your support and guidance and advice as we find a home here in Jakarta. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Professor Kong, for such an exciting, welcoming remark. If you could continue to stay with us on stage to take a seat, there on stage. And with that, we would like to invite our guest of honor, the Minister of Education, Culture, Research and Technology, His Excellency Bapak Nadiem Makarim, to the stage as we, ladies and gentlemen, are about to witness a live discussion. Excellency.
So when Minister participated in the industry dialogue at SMU in 2020, he bowled us all over. It was wonderful to hear his visionary ideas for education in Indonesia, but he also extended beyond that to talk about Indonesia's development, the region's, the challenges that the region faced, the implications for the region amidst global turbulence and so forth. And so we had to invite you again for this session because I know that we will all benefit from your insights. I want to spend the time talking a little bit about unilateralism that is growing in the world today. And with the current global relationships, fractured as they are, wars as we confront them, climate change that is confronting the world, different nations reaching for different goals, saying to one another that you should slow down in your impact on you know, climate and so forth, there are many fissures and fractures in relationships, international relationships in the world today. And yet today we've been talking about collaborations. In this growing world of unilateralism, how do you think the world can come together and collaborate better to overcome the challenges of our time? And they are major challenges, whether they are climate change challenges, pandemics, cross-cultural wars and so forth. How can the world come together better so that we might be able to thrive together?
That's a great question. First of all, thank you, Professor Kong, for having me here. It's a real pleasure, an honor for me to be at this opening of your first overseas center. I actually did not know that it was your first one ever. I thought there might have been one or two before this, but I'm so honored to have SMU choose Indonesia as the first. So please give a round of applause for SMU for an incredibly, I think, important message about the importance of Indonesia and Singapore's relations. With regard to your question, it's a very difficult question to answer, but if I had to make a calculated bet, I would say that the odds are much higher of achieving that with the younger generation. And that's why education is, to me, the highest return on investment for global collaboration. Because at the end of the day, a lot of the fractures, a lot of the unilateralism that we see in the world are derived either politically or derived in society from political pressure or manipulation. I think at the end of the day, the youth that have very little to unlearn have the highest potential to build bridges across nations. And I do believe that education, especially, not exclusively, but especially higher education, needs to play that part with a certain level of ownership. They need to own that task or mandate to actually expose younger people to people of different ethnicities, religion, socioeconomic background, sector, discipline. Because the vaccine to unilateralism or prejudice or exclusive identity politics, the real antidote is only one thing. It is exposure to people on the other side. It comes down to it. There's no rocket science about the psychology of multilateralism or multiculturalism, pluralism. It's just about exposure. And so I think that governments and educational systems, but especially universities and educational systems play an extremely pivotal part in actually pushing the mobility of students to be exposed. One of the biggest reasons why we launched the mobility program together with SMU and other Singaporean universities was we needed to get kids out of Indonesia, as many of them as possible, to expose them to how things are done in other countries, to build networks that will last them a lifetime. So if you ask me, Professor Kong, it's not that I'm not optimistic about the more senior generation, it's just that I believe the higher return on investment is working on the younger generation. And honestly, what we've seen, in, for example, in the past 20 years, I grew up in a Singapore high school. They are still some of my closest friends till today. And we have that has grown into networks of collaboration, of personal, business, and now in the field of education as well. And I believe that having cohorts of multinational friendships from around the world will then automatically generate business collaborations, political affinity and closeness, and third, a cultural sense of familiarity instead of a sense of alienation from a particular country. And so that's, I guess that's my way of answering a very complicated question, but I do believe that the youth are the answer.
You know, coming from education, I firmly support and agree with that. And I think there is a lot to be said for education at a young age and exposure at a young age, and that exposure stays with you for life. You talked about the role of universities in particular. Education is important, but you highlighted universities in particular. How well do you think universities are paying attention to this very important responsibility that they have? And, you know, please feel free to comment on this within the Indonesian context or beyond the Indonesian context. Are universities now paying enough attention to this responsibility, or is that chase for, you know, research rankings and those sorts of things, have they overtaken one of the key missions of what a university should be?
That's a very good question. In my travels and in my current post, I've found that everything is on a spectrum. There are universities that don't care about that at all. There are universities that are trying very hard to make people think that they care about that. And there are universities that care a little bit too much about that. So I've seen it all. I've seen every part of the spectrum of university. And it really does depend on the leadership of the university and what kind of position that they, what position do they take on transforming, right? What is their stance on transformation? So kudos to you, Professor Kong, for making the bold move to set up a center here. I think that's the kind of leadership universities need. And I think that net-net, if you had to ask me, are universities thinking enough about it? I don't think so. Because it's not just about creating programs of exchange. It's not just about sending your students abroad and to bring students from abroad to your university, which is quite simple to do. But that's not going to achieve the overarching goal that will push civilization forward. What I think is needed in universities is also the ability to take risks. One of the most ironic things that I have discovered in my most recent occupation is the fact that everybody, without fail, talks about creating a whole young generation of innovators, of creative thinkers, problem solvers. Creative problem solvers, innovation, name your buzzword. Everybody likes talking about it. But when push comes to shove, how innovative or creative are universities allowed to be? And when I mean universities, I mean either university level, it can be department level, faculty level, or even student organization level. If you really break down the gap between the outwardly expressed intention of making the most creative and innovative kids, students, is remarkably contradictory to how static, fixed, and inflexible most university systems are with their education. So do you see the irony here? Everyone expects this, and yet how is that supposed to happen when the university is not the most innovative and creative as an institution? There's this logical fallacy almost. And so I think that universities, to create this next generation of global shapers, of people that will have impact beyond just making money, you need to reimagine what that university should be like. You need to actually start saying, is putting a bunch of kids in a classroom with a lecturer and then getting examined at the end of it really going to create that generation of shapers and high impact people? And the answer, I think, is a resounding no. It's a no. Universities need to be reimagined, in my opinion, into being the facilitator of an experience of learning. And that does not have to happen on campus. It can happen in companies. It can happen in missions, social projects. It can happen through guided entrepreneurship. It can happen through social entrepreneurship. It can happen through specific trainings that are in the industrial complex. It can be anything. But it definitely cannot just be single sectoral, only in the academic field, only taught by academicians, and only within the confines of a classroom. The hybrid model is what I believe will get us to where we want it to be, and frankly speaking, the only way from preventing universities from fading into irrelevance. And I don't say that to scare anyone. It's definitely fading into irrelevance. I just want to point out the next generation of people coming in are coming into universities understanding they're just doing this to play the game, get good grades, get their networks out. Once they're out, they know they're going to relearn everything anyway from zero. But I'm not happy with that outcome. I don't think university should be a sport for students to get good grades, meet some good connections, then carry that brand with them for the rest of their life, and that's it. I'd like graduates from universities to say at least 50 to 60% of what I did in my undergraduate matters to me now. Matters to my work, matter to my leadership experience, matter to who I am as a person and what I believe in. And to do that, you have to send these kids out. And you have to send the faculty out. And you have to bring faculty from practitioners into campus. And so Campus Merdeka is not just a philosophy to basically increase Indonesia's economy in 20 years. Campus Merdeka was Indonesia's way of saying, we see where the world is headed, and we don't want to be a follower anymore. We know where everyone's gonna go in 10, 15 years. We're just gonna take the shortcut right to there instead of having to play catch up, which is super frustrating because everything in Indonesia, we always have to play catch up. And for the first time, we'd like to be a leader. And that's why support with institutions such as you and SMU doing this and helping that facilitating across an entire country is so amazing for us because we see that our efforts are being reflected in the energy we're getting from the top universities in the world. And for that, we'll always be thank you, Professor Gong. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister. You know, when you talked about universities needing to innovate and to walk that talk, right, not just to advocate innovation and innovative practices, but to actually innovate, I'm reminded of something that I read about how some people, critics, believe that universities are probably the last industry to actually transform. which is a terrible irony, and if true, a terrible indictment of universities. But I'm very happy to share, Minister, that over 90% of our students every year at the point of graduation, when we do a survey with them and we ask them, what has your educational experience been with SMU like? Over 90% of them say it's been transformative, or it has had a very significant, it has made a very significant change in my life. And I think that's what we must believe in education, that we are making a difference, whether it's 50%, 60% of whatever you learned in your undergraduate years, and I don't mean in the classroom only, but whatever you've learned as the totality of your experience stays with you and makes a difference to you through life, that's when we've been successful. And that's very important to us at SMU. Minister, you've been a real advocate of the Youth Mobility Program and the larger philosophy behind that. What are your hopes for the YMP? How can we play a part in helping to achieve those objectives?
Well, I think my biggest hope is that countries such as Singapore and the community of universities within Singapore, and of course other countries, will open up their doors for Indonesian students. I think that's my biggest hope. Because right now, the bottleneck is absolutely not with the Indonesia. We have the funding, we have a huge amount of demand. Our ISMA program, the Semester Abroad program, is by far the most popular Kampus Merdeka program. And they're producing superstars because the top of the pile are just the most amazing kids always. When you have a population that's so big, you know, it's just how it happens. And our only bottleneck right now is on the supply side. So thank you for volunteering to coordinate this effort. But what we'd really like to see is for our top universities across Singapore and other countries to open up their doors for this program. We'd also be honored and would love to host as many students from Singapore into Indonesia to come study with us. We have various ways of, I think the value proposition before was not as interesting for foreign students, but now with Kampus Merdeka, it suddenly got a lot more interesting because you don't have to join, I think the prospect of say an SMU student just joining a classroom with five classes for a semester in a university in Indonesia would not be as exciting as launching a reforestation project that a university is doing, which is now an accredited course for an entire semester because it's a Kampus Merdeka program. It would be so much more exciting for an SMU student to do a Android development course in collaboration with a Google Bangkit program, which is one of our Kampus Merdeka programs. And so the or a research project on marine conservation that maybe UGM or UI is doing. So because we've redefined what it is for a semester to be, now it can be a research project, now it can be an entrepreneurship project, now it can be any one of these wonderful leadership and personal journey experiences, or teaching in Papua or Maluku for a semester, teaching literacy, for example. I think that that will make it so much more appealing for foreign university students to come and experience the country, the university setting, but in a very unique and different way. And I'm sure that a lot of Singaporean universities would love that as well, because it really, Singapore can be a very safe place, right? And the value that Indonesia brings is to expose, for example, Singaporean students to, you know, a variety of challenges. Everything in Indonesia is a challenge. It is, everything. But how do you grow if you don't have challenges? And I think that's what the appeal would be for Indonesia. And for Indonesian students going to Singapore, I think it's about seeing just incredible advances in technology, in sciences, in how infrastructure should be, and so on. So for me, it's a very powerful combination, especially between Singapore and Indonesia, because they're so different. You could not have a more diametric different countries as experiences, but that's also why they complement each other so well. Whatever the other side is missing, is actually what the other side needs to expose their students from. And that's why I always said, Singapore and Indonesia, we are natural partners. We're natural partners in research, in technology. You have a lot of the talent, we have the market. We also have a lot more talent now because, you know, arguably, there's a competition between who's the Silicon Valley of Southeast Asia. I would say Jakarta's winning right now, but I'm sure someone will debate me. But I think that the complementary features of our two countries is what makes it amazing. So that's, in a nutshell, my aspiration for the mobility. And I really hope that this is not just for students. My biggest wish is for faculty to also have that same level of mobility. Our LPDP, our National Endowment Fund, has now, we have really transformed what can be funded. We are now funding all types of residencies, you name it, whatever you want to call it, sabbaticals by faculty and so on. And so we not only fund students, they used to do full semester courses, they used to do full degree scholarships only. We thought, this is silly. It's so hard to get into a full degree program, whether it's a master's or PhD in top universities. Why don't we democratize this program and now unbundle it to be able to provide scholarships for semester-long programs? Now, we applied the same principle for faculty. Now we can faculty can do 6 months, a year, sabbaticals or working opportunities, research opportunities in either industry or in universities abroad. And so that's really the big goal of youth mobility. It's actually a microcosm of what our entire Campus Merdeka philosophy is all about. We want to get people moving, to break down those boundaries between sectors, between disciplines, and so on.
So it's a great vision, and if I were a student, I'd love to participate in some of the programs that you've just described. But universities are very often also slow to change and resistant to change. What challenges have you found in terms of realizing this vision?
I think the better question is, what challenge have I not found in trying to... I mean, you name it, the amount of resistance that we faced early on was overwhelming. So can you imagine, we were sitting on this table and we were debating. Pak Nizam was there. Is Pak Nizam here? There. Pak Nizam was there. Pak Nizam, could you stand up? Because actually, I just want to say, I get a lot of credit for these, but the person actually doing it is that guy over there. Okay, he's the man with a vision and the execution that does this. But I remember that conversation, Pak Nizam, we had, and we had to decide, are we going to just encourage universities to do this? Maybe like give them some incentives to do this program? Or do we just come up with a regulation that forces them to do this? And we went with the latter. And that had two consequences. The first consequence of that was that it created a massive sense of dissatisfaction and reaction from faculty all across Indonesia. That was the initial reaction. The second thing, the second impact of that decision was it actually worked, okay? So, meaning that it would not have worked otherwise. We have a very interesting situation in Indonesia whereby the only centralized educational level is universities. So there's quite a centralized structure of policy. So we use that centralizing, whereas schools are completely decentralized to regions. So we use that authority to actually use a very, kind of, I would say, a pretty radically or extreme approach to the policy, which was creating a fundamental right for undergraduate students to take 3 semesters out of their 8 semesters. For those of you that don't know, Indonesian universities are, I would say, quite similar to Singaporean or European system, whereby you actually take that major for the full 4 years and you graduate. So just to let you know, unlike the American system, the liberal arts system. So we allowed them out of 8 semesters to take 3 semesters outside of their major. Major concentration in Singapore, what do you use? Is it major? Program? Okay, majors. So imagine what that did. That means I'm the head of a faculty And for the past 20 years, I have been perfecting this 8-semester program. And in comes this 37-year-old who has no background in education or government that says that my program must be squeezed into a 5-semester program because my kids, if they get accepted to these other programs, they need to be given full credit as if they had gone to that university. So any student that gets accepted to any of these programs will get accepted, and once they come back, their university is forced to give them full credit as if they've taken 4 or 5 courses. This was the only way to get it done. This resistance lasted for about 1.5 years. I was vilified for about 1.5 years. But then, yes, but there's a happy ending. Because guess what happened? The alumni from those programs came back to campus. And they talked to their friends, who talked to their friends, who talked to their parents, and they talked to their professors. And once those kids came back and said, you know what I did? I spent 3 months trying to teach this boy how to read in the islands of Papua. And by month 4, he was able to read that book. Stories like, I now, for the first time, can fully develop an Android app and understand how to set up the cloud infrastructure around it. I've done computer science for 3 years and I've never had any clue how to do that. Comments like, I actually went to Parliament and completed 3 regulatory bills, even as an errand boy for all these comissies in DPR. And I finally understood how things are done in Parliament and what they actually do, because I get to sit in their meetings and do it. These are 3 examples of social sector, private sector, and public sector programs that these kids graduate and come back from. So once that happened, 2 things happened. The resistance started getting silent. Second thing that happened, the younger generation of faculty who have been craving for this program for so long felt empowered. They felt empowered and they started speaking up. They started actually saying, this is what we'd like our kids to do, this way. So my point is this, if you're not encountering any resistance, you're probably not making any significant change. Okay, you're not. If you're keeping everybody happy, you're probably not changing anything. But resistance always has a timeline. And after a certain point, and it's a very long and painful process for you not to give in, not to give up, until finally people see the benefit, and then it becomes a movement instead of a policy. So I felt that the resistance was extremely strong, but eventually faded. They're still grumbling, they're just not doing it explicitly on social media anymore. It's because of the demand by the students, because at the end of the day, fighting against the aspiration and the perceived value of students is very hard to justify at the end of the day. And what are we in this anyway for, if not for the students, right? So, yeah.
Absolutely. What an amazing story, and there are at least 2 things that I've learned from it. Let the students speak for the benefits of the program, and the resistors will have to back away, number one. Number two, colleagues from SMU, if you're upset about some things I'm trying to do, it's okay. You will get around to it. We've got just a little bit of time left, and I'm really curious about 2 things, so if you will indulge me, just 2 other questions. One, many of the changes that you're thinking of involve faculty and students going to business and industry and public sector. At the receiving end, they must be ready and they must see value in it. Is that a challenge? How can we help the other side, so to speak, come on board? That's the first question. And I'll ask the second question at the same time. You have been an advocate of bringing universities into Indonesia, setting up overseas campuses and so forth. If you were to give advice to a university from elsewhere thinking to do that, What are some of the two or three key things that they should bear in mind?
Great questions. Okay. So the first question is, yes, there was definitely a big problem with trying to get private sector specifically. Government was much easier, strangely enough, to accept students. But to get, probably because I am in government, so I think we always listen to our own kind, right? So, but the private sector were a bit anxious in the beginning. But my experience in the private sector helped tremendously. So I still remember this. We had a Zoom call with probably about, I don't know, 50 to 60, several of them, but in every call we had about 50 or 60 founders, CEOs, or director of HR of companies. And I opened the session by saying, okay, if you are thinking of this as a CSR program, we are not interested. And I think that immediately caught their attention. And I said that, and I said, if it's a CSR program, keep doing it. It's amazing. But what I'm pitching to you is a government-subsidized talent recruitment program for you. The government is going to pay for your own talent development. And once I framed it like that, people started listening. Because I use private sector. Because most of the time, it's always the government asking companies, please make yourself look good publicly by providing CSR. And by the way, some of the CSR programs in education in Indonesia are among the best, I have to say. They are among the best, like incredible programs launched by a variety of philanthropists in Indonesia, really excellent. But this pitch, Kampus Merdeka, to get them to open their doors, I did not want that. I wanted something that even if I did not subsidize it someday, they would continue it. So the logic was this. Okay, what's your number one problem right now? I already know. It's talent. It's always talent. Yeah? Every single organization, every single company of high quality, number one obstacle is talent. Okay. So imagine that you could train every university student the way you want them to train them, right? And then based on that, be able to recruit the best and brightest of that cohort based on your training program. Right. So that program is called Magang Bersertifikat, the internship program, and the project study independent projects. And yes, the government will pay for it. So after that, it was much easier. Some of them did not want to start until the big names began. And once the big names began and started accelerating, so Google started with Google started with how many? 300, right? Next year they will be at 9,000 program. It's become a university. It has 9,000. That's how big these programs have scaled. So seeing that, then it becomes a competitive dynamic between companies. If they're doing that, they're going to get the best and the brightest. If their program is that, then it becomes a kind of self-fulfilling or self-generating push to quality. And I think all the students send reviews and they're available publicly. We read them. And so we can see, you know, which companies are embarrassed about the low quality of their programs and so on. So I think that initially it was hard, but if you speak to them from a private sector perspective, it was much easier to sell that pitch. And to the second question about
Overseas universities coming in,
and what advice I would give is, number one, Monash did all the hard work, so you owe them. The first one out is always the hardest. But after that, now we have the playbook. The playbook is a lot simpler. So we owe Monash and Pak Nizam over there for actually sorting out all the kinks from the regulatory perspective. Now we know what to do, and now we can do it much faster. The second part is, Indonesia is here to stay. If you're still having doubts about whether or not we are going to become an economic superpower, it's only a matter of when. So as a university, having a presence here will be exponentially valuable for your, not just for your research, but for the experiences of your students. And also, if you're worried about whether or not there is demand here at whatever price point, you should go talk to Monash, because there's a huge market here of people that would like education, but maybe their parents aren't comfortable with them going outside of the country. So there's definitely enough of a market here. My advice also would be, choose what is the path of least resistance to your board. Your board is going to be conservative. So pick whatever will get passed first. Menu number one, you can go the SMU route, which I think is a very, very smart route, quick and easy. It's just an overseas center. It's going to collaborate using a lot of events and facilitate student exchange. I'm sure Professor Kong secretly already has a plan in place to make it into an actual institution someday that will be able to facilitate SMU students that want to stay in Indonesia, maybe someday. That's my hope, Professor Kong, my wish. I'm sure you've thought about it already. You can come and set up a full degree program if you want. If you're less confident in that, you can set up a joint degree program with a local university. If you're not so confident in that, you can just do a Campus Merdeka undergraduate one semester program, and then have as many Indonesian university students from other universities come in and do a semester there. And guess what? Once you're comfortable with that one, then you can make another semester, a different course, and another course, and then those are the Lego blocks that you will inevitably stack up to become a full degree program. So with Campus Merdeka, we've unbundled higher education, so you don't have to go with the full high-risk approach. You can just create a six-month program, training course, create the next one, and then stack it on top of each other, and then you can call it a degree in entrepreneurship or in management or in whatever your grouping or theme that matters to you is. So the flexibility is really amazing. And you can generate sustainability very early on, generate scale very early on, because of the unbundled system today. So the options, I think, are plenty. And finally, I think my last piece of advice is work with Indonesian faculty. They are incredible. They have some, especially the risk-taking ones, that will speak their mind and do crazy things on campus and not prioritize their careers. The best professors I've met are the ones that don't rise up in the career rankings because they're so obsessed about that particular project that they're doing, and they don't think about the administrative requirements to advance in their career. By the way, something we're fixing as well. So I think that's the last thing. Find those gems because they are there. And I've heard this from MIT professors, from Harvard professors, and a variety of Singaporean universities that have told me specifically individuals that they're like, I would love to work with that person, naming them by name. So I think that's the other benefit of setting up shop here.
Minister, thank you very much indeed. I think the audience will easily agree with me that it's been a fascinating half an hour where you've taken us 30,000 feet high and actually look at education, the future of the region and so forth with vision and a compelling one, and then been able to draw us to a level of detail where you've shown us what is actually implementable and doable and scaling from 300 to 9,000. So that ability to zoom out and then to zoom in has been just fantastic. And I think the audience will want to join me in thanking you for that very compelling vision. Minister, I want to say thank you too for joining us for the launch of our Overseas Centre. I don't really know what my secret plan is yet, but I'm sure I have one. Thank you very much. Shall I hand over to the MC, please?
Yes, Professor Kong and Minister, thank you very much for this insightful live discussion. Ladies and gentlemen, President of SMU and, of course, Minister Nadiem Makarim, you may return to your seats. Thank you very much. As we're about to prepare for the next agenda of the evening, once again, thank you very much. And ladies and gentlemen, let's give one more round of applause because it has been a very insightful live discussion.
gonna do? Do you wanna get down? What you gonna do? You wanna get out? What you gonna do? You wanna get out? Tell me. How you gonna do it if you really don't wanna dance? By standing on the wall.
Get your back up off the wall.
Tell me. How you gonna do it if you really don't wanna dance? By standing on the wall.
Get your back up off the wall.
I heard all the people say.
Applause for an electrifying performance by the SMU alumni performing group Illuminix, ladies and gentlemen. And now we have come to the moment that we've all been waiting for. May I invite Ambassador Kwok and Professor Lily Wong on stage to officially launch the SMU Overseas Center in Jakarta. Now, the sound of the gong symbolizes the opening or a new beginning here in the region of Southeast Asia. And we already have a gong on stage to begin the launch ceremony. And to do the honor, we would like for Ambassador Kwok and Professor Lily Kong to each strike three times on the gong to officially launch the SMU Overseas Center in Jakarta. So to kickstart this ceremony, we would like to invite Ambassador Kwok to start first. Kindly do the honor, Ambassador. And now, finally, to officially launch the Singapore Management University Overseas Center in Jakarta, Professor Kong, please do us the honor. Ladies and gentlemen, what quite an occasion. Please give a round of applause for the official launch of Singapore Management University Overseas Center in Jakarta. Professor Kong and Ambassador Kwok, please kindly come to the center of the stage. And we would also like to invite our honored guests today, SMU trustees who are also with us today. We have Pak Arif Rahmat, Ms. Lim Kashin, and I think we also still have Professor Nizam with us here, and Bapak Pramoda De Sudarmo, if he's still with us, and of course, Professor Dr. Joni Octavian Haryanto, if he is also still in the room, please kindly join on stage to have a group picture to commemorate the special evening now that it has been officially launched, the Singapore Management University Overseas Center here in Jakarta. Such a momentous occasion this evening. Ladies, gentlemen on stage, please give a hearty smile for the documentation team to document today's event. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, once more, could we please have a celebratory round of applause for the official launch of the SMU Overseas Center in Jakarta. To more future collaborations in the future between Singapore students and Indonesian students. And we have just witnessed such an exciting live discussion of what the opportunities could bring for both Singaporean and Indonesian next generation in the future. And ladies and gentlemen, now that we have witnessed the official launching ceremony of Singapore Management University Center here in Jakarta, I am pleased to say that while we await the next agenda this evening, dinner is ready to be served. So please make yourself comfortable, please enjoy the evening, and bon appetit. We will see you after dinner. Ladies and gentlemen, if you may return to your seats as dinner and dessert is being served now. I hope you are enjoying your dinner. We're about to commence our agenda and we're about to continue with the Presidential Distinguished Lecturer Series. And just a moment, Professor Kong, I'm just making sure that everybody is returning to their seat first before we commence. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, we're about to continue our agenda. Now, we have just witnessed the official launch. Welcome, Singapore Management University to Indonesia, as you've just officially launched your overseas center here in Jakarta. What a momentous event. We've witnessed a very dynamic and insightful live discussion earlier this evening with the Minister of Culture, Education, Research, of course, Technology of the Republic of Indonesia. Now, ladies and gentlemen, as you enjoy your dessert, we'd like to hand it over to Professor Kong to start the Presidential Distinguished Lecture Series. Professor Kong, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much indeed. And to all our guests, I hope you've enjoyed dinner and please continue to enjoy your dessert. We are very privileged today to host our first Presidential Distinguished Lecture Series overseas. We've always done this in Singapore. We typically have one distinguished speaker. Tonight, we have the pleasure of four distinguished speakers and our first one ever overseas. So tonight is a number of firsts in Indonesia, and I'm delighted that we have four very distinguished speakers whom I'd like to introduce. To my right is Ibu Shinta Wijaya Kamdani, and she really needs no introduction. As I heard some of the panelists say to her earlier, they know her, but she won't know them. She is owner and chief executive officer of the Sintesa Group. And there's so much I can say about her, but you know, we won't have time to do justice to all that she does. I will just point out two things. She is president of Indonesia Business Council for Sustainable Development. She's also founder of Indonesia Business Coalition for Women Empowerment. One other thing. She was chosen by the United Nations as one of 30 global corporate leaders to join the Global Investors for Sustainable Development. And she was also chair of B20 Indonesia during the Indonesian presidency of the 2022 G20 summit. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. A warm round of applause for Ibu Shinta. Second to my left is Bernard Tan, country president, Singapore, for cinemas in Singapore and managing director, APP Cinemas. Again, another very distinguished member of the community. Over the last 6 years, he has been intimately involved in sustainability as a function and has been very focused on ESG issues, especially with regard to fire and haze, on the rehabilitation of landscapes, and on carbon markets. And we all know how important these issues are today. On the extreme right is Aldi. Aldi is an entrepreneur, spent most of his career in fintech. Again, very distinguished in all the different things that he's done. Was with the Boston Consulting Group, PayPal, Google, and so forth. Very importantly, and very impressively, a young global leader at the World Economic Forum, not for 1 year, not for 2 years, but for 5 years. So plenty that he's doing. And last but not least is our SMU alum, Gulshan. Gulshan is founder and chief executive officer of Communicating World. He has some 15 years of experience conducting training and coaching for some of the world's most successful organizations in 28 cities across 10 countries. He is president of the SMU Alumni Indonesia chapter and member of the SMU International Advisory Council in Indonesia. Again, I am not doing justice to any of these individuals here, but perhaps even more interesting than their very impressive bios is what we will hear from them during the panel discussion. We had the privilege of a short discussion several days ago online, just to gather our thoughts about some of the key questions that we might want to address during this session. Now, the topic for the session is building a sustainability talent pipeline for Indonesia. Building a sustainability talent pipeline for Indonesia. And, you know, earlier you'd heard about me talking about SMU's sustainable living priority as a strategic priority. We've heard about the educational initiatives and reforms that Minister Nadiem is interested to introduce and embed in the Indonesian higher education ecosystem. And I want to bring the two of them together, those two topics on sustainability and education, and ask ourselves the question of how we might be able to build a talent pipeline in the area of sustainability. Now, that is a topic that is confronting all societies, all economies. In Singapore, there is such a demand for sustainability talent that we have a little bit of a joke going around, which is that if you've been in a sustainability job for 3 years, you are the guru, right? And that's how thin, in a sense, that expertise on sustainability is. Now, in the context of Indonesia, you have the third largest tropical rainforest in the world. You have the world's largest tropical peatlands. You have the world's largest mangrove forests. These natural resources store vast amounts of carbon that mitigate climate change impacts. So in that sense, Indonesia has been termed a climate powerhouse. Your climate mitigation and adaptation measures will have significant, not national impact, not regional impact, but global impact, right? So in the context of what Indonesia can do for sustainability, what I'd like to generate a little bit of discussion around this evening is, do we have the talent pipeline to actually deliver on those ambitions to be a climate powerhouse? And so I want to begin by asking the question of all panelists. If you think about the context of climate change threat, Indonesia's sustainability aspirations, Indonesia's aspirations to develop a green economy, what are the types of skills and workers you need to actually meaningfully contribute to climate action. And not just to contribute to the climate action, but to actually also benefit from growth in the sustainability sector. Right? What types of skills and workforce do we need? I wonder if we might begin with Ibu Shinta to ask your thoughts.
Thank you, Professor Kong. So, first of all, thank you very much for inviting me to speak tonight. I think this is going to be very hard for the four of us because I think we are at the end of dinner and everybody's in a mood of networking. We'll try to share a bit perspective briefly. But what enticed me to come this evening is we talk a lot about sustainability. We talk about how to greening the economy, but we know for sure that the most important part of it is the green jobs, right? So. We talk about technology, we talk about financing, but do we have the talent? Do we have the people? And I think this is where we're here tonight, to talk about, do we have the talent pool in Indonesia for these green jobs? So we all know, I think the answer, we're still in our journey, so still far from where we wanted. But I wanted to start by Indonesia, first of all, in achieving its NDC. Indonesia has actually recently increased its NDC target. So originally we have 29% NDC by 29% on our own, and then we increase it to 31.89%. And then 40% if we get support, and it increased to 43.2%. Why am I talking about the NDC? Because actually, when we talk about the jobs, we also started with the target of the NDC. So of the NDC of Indonesia, actually it has already been separated into the folu, into the energy, into the industry, into the waste sector. So it's clear in each of this sector what's the target of achieving the NDC. So what we did at that time with IBCSD, we worked together with ILO. So we tried to identify what jobs are required to achieve this NDC. We actually did survey in four sectors particularly. One is forestry, second is energy, the third we did in the building, and the fourth in ecotourism. So clearly in those results, we are still very much, we have a big gap. But we look at it as 2 points. One is the existing job. We want to green, we call it greening the existing job. And the second is new jobs, the new jobs that will come in that are required. So after the government put all the target on the NDC on each sector, we identify the jobs that required. Then we see where are we now, and we are still obviously very, very far off. But with that, we start developing what we call the roadmap. So I don't know whether Minister Nadiem mentioned about the occupational mapping that they did for Indonesia on the green jobs. But what this occupational mapping is very important, because then we see what the government want and what the business can provide. There's definitely a big gap. So this is where the academia come in. We need you guys to provide and support us having this training, this education to fulfill these jobs. So what we are encouraging now is for the businesses to work with the education, with the academia, to provide in each of these sectors what are the jobs that are required and the skills that are required. So So we are still very, very far off, as you know, and this is just the beginning, because I think from the very basic of, we talk about industry, we talk about engineers, designers, you know, it's still very minimal. But I think I'm all more concerned about the basic of mindset. When we talk about sustainability, the jobs, the people need to have that mindset that this is important. So it's not that they are just being forced and push into the jobs that are there, but they themselves need to have that mindset and understanding that this is something that they would want to go into. So I think that's I think one point that I wanted to share to begin with, that there has to be an alignment what we're doing, what the government wants to do in the target, what business can provide, and how academia can play a role in providing the education side.
I think that's a really good point. Thank you, Ibu Shinta, that, you know, it's one thing to have the skills and the training for that, but if you don't have the mindset for it, you're not necessarily doing justice to what the work requires. Maybe I could turn to Aldi. You know, we talk about climate change education and how that can be embedded in the system to make change. Could you share your thoughts with us about, you know, some of the efforts of the World Bank in relation to Indonesia's Ministry of Education, Culture, Research and Technology to develop partnerships to build capacity? How do you think that is best designed to be effective? How can that actually effect change in the way that's necessary?
So I think one of the findings from a lot of the papers from many institutions is that vocational training, or like what Nadiem just said earlier, is practical training in the field is the most impactful, right? And because many of the things that we will need to do for sustainability, if we try to build the old route of building a university, creating a curriculum, it'll take too long. By then, it will be too late. So let me give you one example, right? Indonesia, talent eventually follows money, and money follows opportunity. So where is a vocational training the most useful is, okay, where can Indonesia win in climate change? What do we have that no other country has? A vast ocean, right? We have the longest coastline. And it turns out that seagrass actually sequesters, 1 hectare of seagrass sequesters the same as 15 hectares of rainforest, right? So imagine if you have a training program and a, you know, practical training program from somebody here to go to Scripps Aquarium in San Diego, or somebody, or Scripps comes here to create that program. We will be able to create a lot of young, motivated people who actually would understand how do we turn this gold mine of carbon that we have into something real, right? And this can be applied to many, many different sectors in Indonesia, where, as you mentioned earlier, Indonesia's job is to preserve the carbon sequestration areas that we already have. Right. Other countries is to reduce their emissions. Ours is to preserve. But how do we then economically create a way to make that feasible? It is by creating so many professionals on the ground that will be able to figure out business models that are sustainable, that can put us in the world stage. You know, in the same way that Saudi Arabia used to mine oil, we should be able to mine, like financially, the carbon, not actually cut the trees, but create the credits that we deserve so that we can improve the livelihoods of the communities around the areas where the carbon is stored.
Very good. You know, so we've had a perspective from an entrepreneur who's been working, you know, in many different areas. We've got the leader of B20 and a perspective that perhaps we're still on a journey in terms of building the sustainability pipeline. I want to turn to Bernard. You've been in paper and pulp and other areas, and you've been in ESG, you've been interested in ESG and supporting ESG for many years. What are the challenges that you face in terms of recruiting people who could actually support this cause?
Thank you very much, Ibu Lili. Maybe I first start with the fact that we live in very interesting times, and we are on the cusp probably of multiple disruptions, and I would probably highlight two. The first is obviously the information revolution that's going to take another phase and probably bring us to another whole set of disruptions for businesses, government, societies, and so forth. But the one that I think is the one that we can see coming is really the climate change disruption. And if we define sustainability as one generation living in a way that continues to preserve the potential for the next generation, we are simply not doing that. So it's got to change. We've got to change everything that we do. And so this disruption will be quite total. And if this is the job of the sustainability practitioner, then it's actually a far more difficult thing than the information revolution. If you wanted to train somebody to do digital activities, coding, analytics, it's a very clear thing. But how do you train sustainability practitioners? And I sat down over 6 years to think about what qualities do we want to define when we want to recruit somebody. It's actually quite difficult because it's multifunctional. So maybe perhaps I would say the first thing that a sustainability practitioner needs is he needs a little bit of an appreciation of environmental sciences. You need to know what you're doing to the environment, to the land, to the seas, and this requires some form of technical knowledge. Even when you say you want to reduce carbon, there is an equation in which you need to be appreciated. So you need to have a little bit of a STEM background to handle that. The second thing you probably need is to appreciate a little bit of the commercial and the economic basis, how incentives drive behavior, how markets work. And so you probably need a little bit of economics as well. There's also a social element, right? So what are you doing to societies? How do you implement changes such that the people who are at the bottom of the rung are not the people bearing the complete burden, which sometimes tends to be the case, right? And lastly, and I've mentioned this many times before, it's political. Because when we are negotiating agreements in the world, we have to agree who bears the burden, what are the transition paths, and then it becomes what is it in for me and who bears the greater burden. And then it becomes political. So if you want to train a sustainability practitioner, frankly speaking, at a strategic level, he needs to be multidisciplinary. It is a topic that integrates a wide range of disciplines. And I think, you know, like SMU is trying to preach a much broader based education, right? Rather than going deep into one subject, I think a sustainability practitioner needs to join the dots and needs to join the dots cross discipline. So that is the key challenge. And today, we probably don't have sufficient people trained to be able to do that.
So I really appreciate what you said. You know, there is a tendency in academia, but also beyond academia, to think of depth in disciplinary terms. So if you are an engineer, you only have depth if you've been doing a lot of engineering. If you're a political scientist, you only have depth if you do a lot of political science. But the point that I made in a forum in Singapore was that if you want to be a sustainability expert and you're drawing from different disciplines and someone then thinks you're a bit of a dilettante, you know a bit of everything, but you're not an expert and you don't have depth in any one thing, I say wrong. Because your depth is precisely in cutting across, joining the dots, and taking an inter and multidisciplinary approach on a particular theme, in this case, sustainability. And I would say that that's precisely what we're trying to do at SMU, developing undergraduate master's programs in sustainability that draw from different disciplines. Gulshan, you've had the opportunity of an SMU education. You're now in Indonesia, and you're very much in communications and so forth. What is your own sense of, you know, how we can develop a growing interdisciplinary cohort of graduates, certainly within the Indonesian context, who can respond to the needs of the sustainable and green economy?
Wow. Thank you, Professor Lily. I think if I reflect back on my days as an undergrad, I don't think we ever spoke about sustainability 20 years ago. Right? And the world has changed. There's so much more importance. SMU, for example, also offering a second major on sustainability for students, as well as providing so many other programs around sustainability. But, you know, if you look at the individual self, and I'm looking at myself many years ago, I think the first thing that we need to start developing in students these days, in university students, is really the awareness. Everyone knows we have a problem, but we are not aware of how severe the problem is. And that is something we need to keep reminding and talking about. That's really the first part, right? Indonesia, for example, fourth largest nation, 16th largest economy in the world, is the 10th biggest emitter of greenhouse gases, according to some reports. We are actually contributing a lot to this problem. And until we are actually aware, each and every one of us, especially the next generation, and we heard this from Minister Nadiem as well earlier, it's really to empower the young students as they come up, because that generation will really do a lot more than the seniors. So I think the first part is always the awareness we need to start building. After the awareness, what's next is taking action, right? Because if you know something about it, can you actually do something about it? Unfortunately, we live in a world these days where everybody wants to point their fingers to someone else. You know, it's their problem, you figure it out, get the government to do all the work. But the government can create the policies, can create the environment, but at the end of the day, what can we do to create change? Now, I speak as an alumni, of course, of SMU, but today I speak as a business owner. And I think certain things are really lacking in the knowledge space. For example, I run a training company, services-based, and for me, the question is, how can I be more sustainable and yet profitable? So these are the things that I would like to learn, right? What are the best practices other organizations are doing? Unfortunately, we don't have much of that guiding businesses today in terms of the smaller, medium enterprises that we run, which make up a huge part of the Indonesian economy. So I think we need to prepare students, tertiary students, university students to really have that willingness to take action in whatever way we can. I think this whole climate crisis that we're going through, every one of us knows about it, but it really hit me most during the pandemic, because that's when we really decided, oh, now we can't go anywhere, we can only go out, spend time with nature, get some fresh air, and that was when a lot of things changed for us. Our regular outings with the organization, with our organization, for example, used to be dinners and lunches and D&D. Now we were doing hiking trips, right? That's one thing. We, on social media, for example, we share a lot of information, a lot of tips on communication. Now we are sharing how can we save the earth, which is at a very practical level for people to learn, right? And of course, one of the CSRs that we did last year was planting trees in mangrove forests, right? And we love to do that. In fact, some of the alumni also joined us, because I opened it up to the alumni, Ram, Sham, Yasita, managed to join us for that. And, you know, we really made it real. So my point is, we can talk about it all day, all night, but until we actually get down there and do something about it, nothing's going to change. That's the second part. So awareness, number one, action, number two. But number three is advocacy. We need to talk about it, right? At the moment, we're looking at climate change, sustainability, the very sexy PR buzzwords for businesses. But when was the last time we spoke to our friends about it? In our social circles, when was the last time we addressed it and found ways to improve ourselves? So I think the Indonesian younger students, the university students, need to really take this as an agenda, some sort of revolution, talk about it, share, push their way through, like Pak Nadiem earlier mentioned as well, right? The suggestions are not enough. We need to really go out and do stuff. So I think that's what we really need to effectively create that change that, of course, Pak Jokowi is heading at a international and national level.
Very good. A call to action going beyond just discussion and discursive participation. You know, something you said drew my attention to finger-pointing. You know, there's always a tendency to say, you do something about it, or it's your fault, or you should halt your emissions and so forth. And I know, Bernard, from our earlier conversations that you have a perspective on this. I'd love to welcome your comments.
I think sustainability, the burden of sustainability falls very different on different societies and different countries. I'd like to suggest that, you know, the theory of change, of how you affect pressure, is first you go after the global supply chains. So if you're a leader, for example, like your McDonald's or your Amazon, an Amazon sustainability pledge will be very, very powerful because obviously it affects the entire supply chain all the way down to the sourcing countries that you come from. And obviously then, you know, the pressure will be put on these global supply chains, and NGOs are the one that put pressure on these entities. But the other one that it falls on are those countries that produce the goods that feed the supply chain, which countries like Indonesia, where you're a primary producer. You're producing primary elements that go into all the things that we consume around the world. And that's where Indonesia bears another set of burdens. There are countries that are in the middle that provide services, right? Those perhaps won't bear so much of that burden because obviously it's the consumption and manufacturing and the production chain that actually causes it. So in a sense, sustainability falls heavy on these two. It falls heavy on Indonesia. Again, Professor, for the reasons you have mentioned, not only is it a primary producing country, it also holds much of the world's carbon stock, right? Again, Indonesia has gone on a path of exploiting its resources to promote development and growth. Today, it is told that you can't take that path. Then what is the alternative for Indonesia to develop? It is still a developing country. It still has millions of people in poverty. What is the path? And again, that is not an Indonesian problem, it's a global problem. Because if it continues on the same path it was, we lose our carbon stocks, we add to the greenhouse gases. What aid, what help will the world be willing to give countries like Indonesia to help them transit into a green economy? And maybe I'll just chip in for the carbon markets. I believe the carbon markets is one way of that happening. If you're a carbon producer and you produce carbon like crazy and you need to offset it, pay for a carbon credit to go to a carbon sequestrator like Indonesia. That money will contribute as foreign development investment into Indonesia and allow Indonesia to then take that money and transit into a different growth model, a different development model that is far greener and allow that to make the transition. So I think carbon markets actually at its nub is actually represents social justice at a global level. So I, for one, am very keen on the development of a global carbon market, although we're still quite far away from one. Mm.
Thank you. I'm sure some of these discussions may have emerged in the G20, B20 platform. And I wonder if Ibu Shinto, you could share with us some insights from the discussions there around some of these topics.
Yes, very much so, Professor Korn. As you know, in the B20, we have six task forces and one action council. Specifically, we discuss the future of work. And, you know, this is something that is very important. When we talk about in the energy sustainability and climate, we talk about the energy transition. Everybody's talking about energy transition. You go anywhere, we talk about how, you know, we can start retiring our coal and then go into more renewable. We even get money, Professor Kong. So one of the outcome of the G20, B20 is actually money sitting there, you know, able to finance all this energy transition. But the point is, we can't just be talking about energy transition without talking about just transition. It has to be the just model. We need to ensure the people surrounded. You know, how is this going to impact their jobs? Indonesia is one of the emerging economy that's been focusing a lot on fossil fuel. We understand that, you know. So how do we transfer this? How do we have this shift of jobs and start, you know, preparing the skills for the renewable, for example? While we are talking in that respect, we know, I can only talk about Indonesia itself, we still have issue on our link and match at this moment. Because what's out from the education cannot be absorbed by the industry. This is still a problem. So while we have a shift of job, you know, moving into new skills, But we still have from the basic. So this is where I mentioned this to the minister as well, that we need to pay attention from the basic on the curriculum of the education. So one area is vocational. Yes, of course, we are now pushing. The industry is now working with the government on the vocational. But we also have to pay attention on the education from basic, from the education, when they can include that in the curriculum. We talk about sustainability. Sustainability is not just, we have to start it when they are at a very young age. This is basic. This is about lifestyle. This is about, these days the young generation are doing recycling, all the, this has to be part of this curriculum. So it cannot be just high-level education, what I'm trying to say is how we can put, even starting from the environment, being part of the Indonesian curriculum. So we talk a lot about education in the B20, but what is important is the model. Because we can't be talking about just individual, we cannot just be talking about what we want to achieve, but what is the right model that can work? And this is why we are very much encouraging, for example, on the energy transition, to find that just model. How is this going to impact? How is this actually going to work within the people? You're right talking about poverty. At this moment, we're still talking about poverty, how to alleviate poverty. We're still talking about creating more jobs for Indonesia. So how can people think about, greening the jobs when you're taking only the basic of how can we create jobs in general, right? So all this needs commitment. And the commitment has to also come politically from the government to want to make this happen. And that model, we learn from other countries that's already moving. We have to adopt the right model into this. There's definitely, we see during the B20 discussion, the gap between the advanced countries and the emerging economy. So this is what we address. We said, you can't just be talking. Give us the right model. Support us. How are we going to make this happen? So I think concretely, we need to make a leap to make sure this model can work in many countries, because we cannot enough be just talking about it. We know we want to make it happen, but how can we actually make it happen? And that is, I think, the model that needs to fit. And this is where, again, I'm really, really requesting that, like SMU, how can you actually work with us and supporting in some of this area to find, maybe focusing on certain curriculum or, I know you're working more on the high level education, but looking into what is really the right proper fit into what Indonesia need at this moment.
So I think that's a really good point that, what can we do as educational institutions in contributing to that transition that we're hoping to make? And one of the things that we're doing, of course, is introducing into the undergraduate and postgraduate curriculum sustainability themes. But one of the things about undergraduate education is that it takes 4 years for a graduate to actually get into the workforce. And do we have that time to wait 4 years? So one of the sorts of programs that we deliver in SMU is the continuing education programs for people who are already in the workforce, who can transit through short programs to pick up the sustainability skill sets and knowledge so that they can apply them quite readily. And one of the reasons why we're establishing an overseas center in Jakarta is because we think that some of our programs in digital transformation and sustainability and so forth might be things that we could offer here that can help with the transition to a green economy or a digital economy.
Just adding one thing, I think now in most of our trade agreements, because I'm supporting the government with the negotiation of trade agreement, we put capacity building aspect and a lot of got to do with vocational. Right. So I think on the vocational, we also have some very specific vocational on specific jobs. Mm. And I think this needs to be included. Mm. What I mean is maybe the G2G will strengthen in order for us to actually apply it and implement it more successfully, So I think the G2G element will also help.
Indeed.
But you know, one of the things about preparing a talent pipeline, it could be for the workforce, but it's as important for it to be preparing entrepreneurs, right? New ideas, new sustainable solutions. And I wanted to turn to Aldi as an entrepreneur to seek your comments about the entrepreneurship scene and what energies are being directed to sustainable solutions, green solutions. Do you see a lot of interest amongst young people in this area? What are the areas that, you know, entrepreneurs might be encouraged to go into, startups can go into, to address some of the climate challenges, climate change challenges?
No, thank you. I think the reality is that we are still in probably the 1.0, approaching the 2.0 phase of technology entrepreneurship in Indonesia. Like, you know, GoPay, what we worked on before, Gojek, is all infrastructure companies, foundational in the US, built in the 90s. Now we're starting to see the 2.0 companies, which leverages the infrastructure of these technology companies to build on top. So it's more of the credit models, you know, the insurance, like in fintech or in travel, it's more bespoke solutions. So in tech, I think that's, we're still evolving a long way. So I feel like right now, to be honest with you, most of the entrepreneurs are still focused on technology. And another area that is probably related to sustainability is economic empowerment for the lower pyramid. Because as Shinta mentioned, if they can't eat, they can't think about not cutting a tree, right? So I think this second generation of startups which focus on the economic empowerment will be quite impactful, you know, green and sustainability-wise without even wanting to be green. Now, there are a host of startups now thinking about sustainability. For example, I recently invested in a electric motorcycle company, right? I think that's coming up because the president has created a mandate of energy transition for vehicles. And so big companies are doing it. So whenever big companies are building something, there's always gonna be some young entrepreneurs who are hungry, they think they can do it better. And most often they're not, they can. Another one is actually carbon sequestration. So, you know, I think Bernard mentioned that we are a gold mine for carbon, right? But it's actually very hard. Like getting carbon credits from ferro and like all this stuff is complicated, right? So there needs to be technology that enables the carbon to be traced all the way to the source in a much more efficient way than what it is today. So I do see innovation happening in those two areas, in particular in Indonesia, in entrepreneurship.
So as a small pitch for what SMU does, we run probably Asia's largest global business plan competition. It's the Lee Kuan Yew Global Business Plan Competition. And our team is actually here soliciting teams to participate in next year's edition. And the theme is on building sustainable futures. So, yeah, so to the extent that there are young people with ideas, pitching their ideas against ideas and, you know, getting VC support, getting you know, mentors and so forth, that is a platform for surfacing good, new, sustainable ideas for startups and entrepreneurs.
Professor Carr, maybe adding just a little bit, we actually just launched also the Indonesia Impact Fund, in which we are supporting and investing in a startup that does SDG. So we're focusing on a certain number of SDG. So what I'm saying is there are many opportunities to work together, you know, reinvent the wheel, because there are many things that's happening also in Indonesia, and I think partnership will be definitely the way.
Absolutely, absolutely. I'm conscious of the time, and I'm therefore just going to direct one last question to each of you. It's the same question, and it is to ask you what your own personal commitment to supporting the building of a talent type pipeline might be to drive sustainable growth in Indonesia. Your own personal commitment to helping to build the talent pipeline. Shall I begin with Gulshan?
Okay, so at the moment, in terms of me personally running an organization focusing on training development, our focus is communication. Number one, we need to lead by example, right? Are there things that we can do to first create our business to be more sustainable in terms of what we're using, our suppliers, choosing sustainable options? That's first. Can we support businesses more? So now in Indonesia, we're seeing banks, for example, giving lower interest rates after looking at organizations' sustainability, their commitment to ESG, blah, blah, blah. So we're seeing a lot of that. Can we do the same, for example, right? Can we choose our clients more wisely, for example? That's the second thing we could do. Of course, we really want to put sustainability in everything we do to help us make the right decisions going forward. Because at the moment, for small, medium enterprises, it's always profitability versus sustainability. What may be profitable may not always be sustainable. What may be sustainable may not be profitable. So I think finding that right balance is something we all need to commit to. I'm thinking on the top of my head, in terms of supporting sustainability, we train organizations, multinational banks on communication, how they can work better, achieve greater goals. But can we now also start working with organizations, NGOs, for example, that are there to talk about sustainability? Can we work with them to develop their communication skills? Can we strengthen their pitch to businesses as they go out? I think that's something that I would like to look at in the next 1 year as a result of today's discussion, right? And it really got me thinking into what are we doing as a business to really empower the NGOs, schools, businesses into doing more. So we want to be that enabler for businesses to be able to reach more people when they talk about sustainability, when they go to schools and talk to students, teaching students about what it means to plant more trees, take care of what they're using, what products they're using. We want to be that organization that can actually help empower them to strengthen their message, because we believe that that will help eventually affect so many more people around in Indonesia.
A very concrete thing that you can do, and I'm delighted that the discussion is nudging that action. Bernard, what are your thoughts on this?
Well, Professor Lily, the Cinemas Group is obviously a conglomerate that actually engages in a lot of primary production as well. And we are probably one of the largest hiring employers of sustainability practitioners. I think for the junior level, the on-the-job training is probably sufficient to get them there. But really, if you look at the higher level, it's all about exposure. Mm. And so this exposure can be informal courses that we can send them to, but it also can be in activities and different conferences, interaction with, you know, top-level practitioners, which is how we all actually do learn what really matters, what people are concerned about. And from there, because we're such a large company, we tend to obviously also have turnover. We like to think that many of our people move on to different jobs in the ecosystem so that we become part of the contributor to that talent pool.
Excellent. Impact beyond your immediate organization. Ibu Shinta, you must have so many things you can do and want to do.
Well, Professor Carl, to begin with, when I'm championing sustainability, I know that I have to lead by example. So my organization, the Sintesa Group, is a family business. We've been in Indonesia for over 100 years. I'm the third generation. So, you know, when I took over and, you know, I realized we have to transform ourselves. So our vision is to become a sustainable excellence company. And I'm proud to say that Sintesa have the SDG roadmap. So we have Sintesa for the Earth that is embedded into our business model. So business model, business process is all aligning with the SDG. And we're focusing on a certain number of SDG. And for us, sustainability has become part of our DNA. Mm-hmm. And I made it very clear that KPI is not just about your performance, but it's also incorporating a lot of our values. And that's also related to the SDG goals that we want to achieve. So we have 16 subsidiaries, and each we have sustainability committee. And a sustainability committee is not just somebody who's in charge of sustainability. But I think their role is also on the governance issue, because we are following ESG. I think it's important that what we do, that we can report back, right? Yes. And I think the sustainability assessment and reporting are equally important. We can't just be saying, putting a jargon that we want to do this, but are we actually doing it? We have to measure it. Yeah. I think that's very important. So we are totally committed to this. I know this is a long way to go. I said to my father, you know, it's easier if I start like an entrepreneur like Aldi, if I start from scratch on our own, I think it's much easier than getting already businesses running right. and have to transform it. Believe me, it's much, much more difficult than starting from scratch. So, but I'm very optimistic that we have to achieve this. And I think what's important is the people. Yeah. That's why the talent pool, identifying the talent pool that are committed to this is very important. But you have to relate this to their compensation and benefits. That's why the KPI is very, very important. Mm. And this is why we have also, within our own group, we have competitions, we have challenges, because we want them to translate what they do into what the actions that they need to achieve. So again, you know, this is a big ambition, but I'm happy at least we have fundamentally, you know, at least we have this roadmap that we are holding to, that we are, you know, capturing in all our businesses.
Thank you. Impressive. Over 100-year business that is seeking to transform, and very pragmatic and practical in insisting on measurables, because that's what gets measured gets done. Aldi, would love to hear your thoughts. You have the last word.
So I believe that entrepreneurs, young entrepreneurs especially, will find solutions to sustainable problems that we haven't thought about. So my commitment is to mentor and invest in these entrepreneurs who have built businesses to improve sustainable land use, the green economy, such that they can further the goal of sustainability in Indonesia. A good example is e-fisheries. They enable the production of fish in a much more sustainable way than through fishing in the ocean. And I think there are solutions that are economically viable, technologically more advanced, and yet also green. But it just takes a young entrepreneur to muck about and figure it out. And our role is to foster, invest, and mentor them.
Thank you very much indeed. I would throw the question to each of us in the room, not for answering right now, but to ask yourself, what is your personal commitment to building a more sustainable future, whether it's through building a talent pipeline, whether it's through your individual action, whether it's through your corporate action? What can each of us do to make a difference in building a greener and more sustainable society and economy? Bernard.
I wonder if you indulge me before. I know you're going to end, and I don't dare anybody else.
Yes.
But I thought I would share with you one last story. I was at the World Cup. I was one fortunate person to be in Doha. And in Doha, you know, we've seen stories of the Japanese supporters cleaning up the stadium. They will actually bring their bags. I actually sat with them. They will bring the blue bags, and it was distributed among the Japanese supporters, and they would stay back to collect the rubbish. And so I met the president of the Japanese Football Association, and I just wanted to know, is this something that's trained? And he says, you know, Bernard, in Japanese society, we have this rule from the time we're in kindergarten, that when we leave a place, we try to leave it better than when we found it. And that means in kindergarten, you clean up. When you eat in a food court, and the Japanese do this, they do clean up. And when you play football, my players clean the field. And when they sit in the stadium, they clean the area around them. I thought to myself, isn't that a wonderful motto for all of us to have? If we leave this planet better than we found it.
Indeed. A wonderful message. Clean up after yourself. With that, I really want to thank our speakers for spending the time with us. They have shared, you know, very good ideas. They've shared the challenges, and they've shared their personal commitments. I also want to thank the audience for staying with us. We have detained you this evening for quite a number of events and activities, and I'm delighted that you were able to join us. Thank you for your support for SMU, and we look forward to working with you in many different ways in the years and in the months and years ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Kwok and panelists, for the amazing Presidential Distinguished Lecture Series, for your stories, and possible opportunities for collaboration. Well, Professor Lily Kwok, now it's time to present our panelists with a token of appreciation. So to all of our panelists, if you could maybe join us here, maybe stand up, and we'll start with Pak Aldi Haryo Pratomo. receiving the token of appreciation from SMU, and Ibu Shinta Wijaya Kamdani, thank you very much for joining this Presidential Distinguished Lecture Series. And Mr. Gulsham Haryani, thank you. And of course, with the most relevant recent story, Mr. Bernard Tan, thank you so much for sharing the Japanese fans in Doha. And gentlemen, ladies on stage, if you could scoot together to the center of the stage for a final group photo to close the evening. And ladies and gentlemen, once again, this was the Presidential Distinguished Lecturer Series of tonight's official, very first Presidential Distinguished Lecturer Series here in Indonesia. Can we give one last hearty round of applause for the panelists and the Presidential Distinguished Lecturer Series? And to all of our panelists, thank you very much. You may return to your seats. thank you. Oops, careful, Aldi. Well, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It has been a very eventful evening. Thank you for staying, because finally we have come to the end of our agenda this evening. Let's just give one last hearty round of applause for Singapore Management University for finally opening their overseas center here in Jakarta. And through all of these discussions today, it looks like it's going to be a great, bright future of collaboration between Singapore and Indonesia. And hopefully, as mentioned by the minister, Professor Kong, maybe you will come up with your secret plan very, very soon. And I am Karina Surya, and thank you so much, everybody, for being with us today. And it has been such a pleasure to host today's eventful night. And please, see you perhaps in the next event with SMU here in Indonesia or perhaps in Singapore. Take good care and have a great night.